transmitting live from the heart of Times Square on 99.5 FM, WBAI New York, Pacifica Radio for the Tri-State Area. This is Trump Watch, a weekly series investigating the actions of and reactions to President Donald J. Trump and his administration. I'm your host, Jesse Lent.
Conrad Tokyo, Sparrow, Pistachio, Justin Nashville, dog is off sabbatical, rather watch an interview.
As I've said, and I'll elaborate more, I want the State Department to get its swagger back. We need our men and women out at the front lines, executing American diplomacy with great vigor and energy, and to represent the finest nation in the history of civilization. We should be proud of that, and I'm counting on you all to help communicate in every corner of the world. Mr. President, I have full confidence that my team here in Washington and around the world under your leadership can and will execute that mission for the benefit of the American people. And I'm eager to work with you all to get that job done. You all know this is essential work. That's why you're here. It's why I'm here. I look forward to doing this together. Thank you all so much for the warm welcome I have received in these first days. I can't wait to get after this with you. Thank you again, Mr. President, for your trust and your leadership and your faith in me. Thank you.
That was Secretary of State Mike Pompeo being sworn into office by President Trump back on May 2nd, footage courtesy of the Washington Post. But exactly how warm has the welcome been for Pompeo at the State Department less than 2 months into his mission to help the agency, quote, get its swagger back, as described in that clip? And how has his approach to being Secretary of State differed from that of his predecessor, Rex Tillerson? Hello and welcome to episode 75 of Trump Watch. Tonight, we'll explore Pompeo's time at the State Department and what it means for U.S. policy with Nahal Toosi of POLITICO, who will be joining us live. There's no denying immigration is front and center in the public discourse right now, with the continued outrage about the more than 2,000 children separated from their parents and detained in cages in recent months as a result of the Justice Department's zero tolerance policy at the border, with the Supreme Court upholding the president's travel ban for seven mostly Muslim countries in a 5-4 decision on Tuesday, and Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy's imminent retirement, which he announced today in a letter to President Trump, as reported by CBS News, signaling many more conservative victories on immigration and other subjects likely to come down from the high court. But though we've covered the issue of immigration extensively on this show, both in last week's program and even in our first show ever, and we'll continue to cover it, tonight I wanted to take some time to look at what the U.S. government is doing when we enter foreign countries through the diplomatic actions of the State Department. It's often said that the Secretary of State is the face of diplomacy in America, so what does it mean that it is the face of former CIA Director Mike Pompeo? We'll take a look at how Pompeo is shaping the department with Nahal Toosi, a foreign affairs correspondent for POLITICO, whose June 25th article, Pompeo gives U.S. diplomats, quote, dose of reality after early high hopes. State Department employees hoped the new Secretary of State would be a clear improvement over Rex Tillerson, but now see some unsettling early signs, explores the way he's being perceived from within the agency. She joins us now live. Hello, Nahal. Welcome to Trump Watch. Thanks so much for being on the show.
I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
Before we get into the contents of your article, could you tell our listeners a bit about Mike Pompeo's personal history? He served in the Army before becoming a congressman for Kansas's 4th District, where he served from 2011 to 2017, the year he became CIA director. But what was his record like, both as a congressman or while he was at the CIA?
Well, as a congressman, Mike Pompeo really cuts out a striking figure, especially when it comes to partisanship. He was probably one of the most vocal GOP hawks, very, very anti-Obama on any number of levels. And, you know, he went after Hillary Clinton on the Benghazi case, and with a vigor that was unlike most other politicians. And he also was a really major opponent of the Iran nuclear deal, So he was so very partisan that actually when he got the CIA job, people were a little bit worried, you know, because the agency, most of its people are not partisan. They try to just do analysis and intelligence, and they don't want their stuff to be politically tilted in some indirect way. And so there were concerns that Pompeo wasn't going to be able to look at these things objectively. But, you know, he spent 15 months there, and you know, while there were some reports that he was probably more hawkish on certain countries, particularly Iran, than some of the CIA's analysts were, generally speaking, he got a pretty favorable review of how he handled the CIA. But those questions about his partisan instincts follow him to the State Department as well.
One standard line of punditry with Trump tapping Pompeo to replace former ExxonMobil CEO Rex Tillerson was that the president had grown close to Mike Pompeo because as CIA director, he was the one tasked with giving the president his daily security briefings. Do you know if that's true? Do you buy into that theory?
Well, I think that's a big part of it. I mean, Pompeo was with the president practically every day. I believe it was one of Pompeo's aides who actually gave the briefing, but the CIA chief was there. In fact, he even had a little office near the White House, so he didn't necessarily have to go back to the CIA's headquarters all the time. And yeah, he just cultivated that. But he also was one of the people who took a lot of pain to not appear in conflict with the president publicly. Like, he would never say anything to contradict President Trump publicly. If he'd said anything that seemed to contradict him, he would always couple it with something that made it seem like the president was right or may be right. So he was very, very careful about what he said. And, you know, it was kind of he was kind of lucky because as CIA director, he didn't have to speak nearly as much as someone like Secretary of State Rex Tillerson, who frequently had to go out there and speak out publicly and to America's allies and its adversaries. And Tillerson just didn't have quite the luxury of being able to agree with Trump on absolutely everything.
Why do you think that was?
Well, you know, there were just a lot of decisions that were under Tillerson that Pompeo didn't necessarily have to make. Like, for instance, when it came to the Iran nuclear deal, it's the Secretary of State who has to tell the president, okay, I believe that this has been certified, that the Iranians are upholding the deal and that you should continue to waive the sanctions on Iran. And so Tillerson, you know, looking at what people were telling him, including, you know, U.S. allies and IAEA inspectors, these are UN inspectors who were inside Iran constantly monitoring its nuclear work, you know, he would have to go to tell Trump every few months, look, you need to go ahead and keep hanging on to this nuclear deal. And that drove Trump crazy, you know, because he didn't like the nuclear deal. And he promised during the campaign that he would rip it up. So that was one of those areas where, you know, Tillerson and Trump just didn't get along. And Tillerson kept saying, look, I think that we have to uphold our end of the deal. It's a good thing for national security to keep this deal. But Trump just completely disagreed.
And of course, there was the famed incident of Tillerson calling Trump an effing moron, a statement, well, that he didn't say the nicer version of that, the one we can't say on the air because of FCC regulations. But that the thing about that, which obviously is always trumpeted out in discussions like these, but he never took that back, which I thought was an interesting choice.
Well, first of all, thank you for warning me we can't curse on this show. I'm glad you told me that.
With this administration, that's an important distinction to make.
Well, these are very strange times, especially when it comes to language and the use of language. You know, the thing about Rex Tillerson that's really interesting is he really does care about his reputation, and he has this whole thing about the Boy Scouts. Like, he was a Boy Scout. He, you know, was really heavily involved with the Boy Scout, and being honest and respectful, et cetera, and not lying was actually one of his creeds, you know. And so he said that he wasn't going to play the Washington game, you know, and say whether or not he called the president a nasty name. But I think it suggested that he had done it and that he had called the president a moron and that he didn't want to lie publicly by saying that he hadn't done it. And so that was, you know, in a way, a mark of his integrity. Maybe.
In your June 25th Politico article, Pompeo gives U.S. diplomats a dose of reality after high hopes. You write that when Mike Pompeo took over as Secretary of State in April, U.S. diplomats viewed him as a liberator, rescuing them from the irrelevance they felt under his predecessor, Rex Tillerson. Can you talk about the staffing cuts Tillerson enacted and how they affected morale, and also what State Department diplomats thought Pompeo would do about it?
Well, yeah, I mean, when Tillerson took over, people thought, okay, he's run a large corporation. He ran ExxonMobil, so he's going to be a good manager, and maybe he'll be a little weak on foreign policy since he's not really done that, but he'll get up to speed. But the funny thing was at the time that the main complaints about Tillerson were actually about his management style and his management ability. And, you know, whereas on foreign policy, he took a lot of fairly conventional Republican positions on any number of things, you know, often meant he clashed with Trump. But putting that aside, people at the State Department, you know, were really concerned about the way Tillerson ran the building. He basically isolated himself. He had a few aides who very strictly guarded access to him. They centralized control over all sorts of decision making in the building, which meant a lot of decisions took too much time to get made or were just never made. He didn't really engage most of the building. I mean, instead of like talking to these diplomats who have been there for decades and getting their expertise on any number of issues, he just had a handful of people he was willing to turn to. Several of them brought from the outside, and they just didn't utilize the expertise that was already there. At the same time, the president proposed cutting the State Department by 30% its budget, its staffing, and Tillerson, you know, felt like he certainly didn't oppose that, at least not publicly, and he immediately out of the gate said he wanted to cut some 2,300 positions from the State Department, especially like 8% of the American citizen workforce, the State Department. And, you know, he did this without really doing any kind of evaluation of what needed to be cut, what didn't need to be cut. And so people were really, really frustrated. At the same time, he just wouldn't fill all these tons of leadership positions. I mean, these are like really important jobs. Assistant secretaries, undersecretaries, many of them were simply left unfilled under Tillerson's reign. And people just felt completely lost, like they lacked leaders, like they were not a priority. At the same time, he wasn't getting along with Trump. So the State Department's voice was not really being heard in all of these major policy discussions that were going on between the White House and the various agencies. So this all just came down to a situation where people really felt like they just needed someone new. And Pompeo, given the fact that he had the president's ear, and given the fact that, you know, over time he said that he definitely wanted to fill all these positions, that gave people a lot of hope that he was going to be a better manager and someone who would make them more of a player, make the State Department more of a player within the administration.
But you report that this initial optimism within the department about Pompeo has quickly started to fade. What other specific actions have led to this quick shift in sentiment?
Well, there's been a number of things, and some of them are not entirely in Pompeo's control, but people nonetheless feel like he hasn't stood up for them the way that he could, given his role. One of them is he said on one of his first announcements that he was going to lift the hiring freeze at the State Department, which was something Tillerson imposed. This really made a lot of people happy. But then after the details came out of exactly what he was going to do, it turned out that a lot of the jobs that Tillerson had eliminated were going to stay eliminated. And the department, simply to this day, like, you know, they'll give me some numbers, but they won't tell me a lot of the context. But the one thing they have told me is they don't expect to go back to the pre-Tillerson hiring levels that, you know, despite what Pompeo has said. So a lot of people at the State Department feel a bit unhappy about that. They feel like he kind of misled them. But that aside, you know, there have been other major concerns. One has been that there's been this ongoing frustration under the Trump administration that the political appointees of the administration, these are people brought from the outside to join the administration in leadership roles, that they have been targeting the career staffers. These are civil servants and foreign service officers who work for the government all the time. They're bound to serve whatever administration is in charge and to implement the policies of whatever party is in charge. And they do this, you know, with a lot of pride. But yet, the Trump administration, many people in it, seem to view these civil and foreign service officers as potential, you know, like some people that they can't trust. And so there's been some people, there's been one case of a woman who was hired before Pompeo, just to be clear, but not too long before him. And she came on board the State Department, and basically the reports say that she has been vetting career staffers' social media pages and their past actions, including stuff that they did under Obama, under that administration's guidance, to find out how loyal these people are to President Trump. And it's gotten so nasty in her particular bureau that there are at least three officials who are about to leave their jobs, top officials, because they feel like she's been harassing and bothering them. And so this has happened, and yet, you know, Pompeo hasn't fired this woman. He hasn't, as far as we know, taken any steps to reprimand her. And so a lot of people at the State Department feel like this is a time for him to be standing up for them, and yet he hasn't done that. And so that's just another example. And there's several other issues, including, you know, some of the people that the White House has cleared to work at the State Department that who appear to be either unqualified for their roles or basically in complete ideological opposition to the role that they're going to be taking. And, you know, Pompeo just seems to be willing to go along with it. And that's really upset a lot of people at State.
This is Heather Nauert you're talking about at the State Department.
No. Actually, Heather Nauert is the State Department spokeswoman. And that's actually another aspect of the story. Basically, because there have been leaks from the State Department to reporters like myself, this has made Pompeo very unhappy, and he has basically asked people to stop the leak. So Heather has been pushing her colleagues in the public affairs section to be very careful about their contact with reporters. And this has made a lot of people unhappy, too, because they feel like, you know, they already tend to follow the rules anyway, but now everything has to go through Heather, and they just feel like it's gotten too centralized and they're too nervous, and they just feel like Pompeo and his aides don't trust them, and that really bothers them.
Have you been affected by that shift?
You know, I like to think I'm a really good reporter. No, I'm being a bit of a braggart there. You know, so far it's been good. I haven't been too affected, although I will say that in the last week or so, I have seen this weird shift of some sort where it seems like the department officials, they won't go on background. They won't go on the record. There have been fewer briefings, although that might be a coincidence. And, you know, they sometimes just want to stay off the record, which frankly is pretty useless in a lot of ways for a reporter. And I'm wondering if this is something that's going to continue, and I'm going to keep my eye on it because it does disturb me. But so far, the sources who have been helping me have continued to help me, and I'm really grateful for that.
I'm speaking with Nahal Toosi, a foreign affairs correspondent for Politico. You're listening to Trump Watch. My name is Jesse Lent. Nahal Toosi, there's no denying that Pompeo's most high-profile achievement so far in the less than 2 months that he's been Secretary of State was the diplomacy he engaged in surrounding the June 12th Singapore summit between President Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Can you talk a little bit about Pompeo's role leading up to the Singapore summit and what he's been doing since then?
Well, Pompeo has played a major role. For one thing, at the CIA, they have always had a back channel to North Korea. So even when the U.S. hasn't had diplomatic ties or conversations with North Korea, the CIA has always been able to talk to their North Korean counterparts. So Pompeo had that advantage going in as Secretary of State. As Secretary of State, and actually just right before he became Secretary of State, he has visited North Korea on two occasions, meeting with the leader there, Kim Jong-un, which was very, very unusual. And it was a huge step to take and a bit of a political risk. But yet he did that. He led the efforts to set up the summit in Singapore. And you know, the summit happened, and it happened, and a lot of people did not think it was going to happen. I was one of those who thought, you know what, it'll happen, but it'll probably be delayed. But no, it ended up happening. And the fact that it went off was considered a bit of a victory. That being said, you know, this agreement, and I don't even like using that word agreement because I think it's too strong a word for the statement that Trump and Kim came up with at the end of it, pledging to work further toward the concept of denuclearization of the peninsula. It's really very weak. It does not include a number of things that Pompeo and others have said that they would want to see it include. And it restates promises that North Korea has made and broken in the past. So the road ahead is way, way more important than what's come so far. And Pompeo today on the Hill, he talked a little bit about this. He would not give a lot of details about what the negotiations are looking like, but he says that there's definitely lots of people working across the government to go ahead and keep up future talks with North Korea so that they can come up with a more comprehensive deal or plan about denuclearization. But again, I really feel like he's got a lot to prove still on that front, and that's going to be tough.
Do you think this remains his number one priority, or now that the summit has happened, has this fallen slightly on the list?
I think it's probably still his top priority, and I say that because the administration has long said that North Korea and its nuclear program is the number one foreign threat to the United States. So I think this is very much atop his list. I would say number two is probably Iran and containing what the administration views as a malign threat from Iran. But, you know, North Korea is the one with the nukes. So that's going to be the bigger priority.
To go back to the point you were making a minute ago about the new ways that certain members of the State Department are being vetted, I believe actually the person you were mentioning was Mari Stahl, a political appointee in State's Bureau of International Organizations, which deals with entities such as the UN. And as you mentioned, she was vetting career employees' social media pages. And
allegedly,
according to this foreign policy report. How accurate do you think that this report likely is, and have you heard of other ways that these career diplomats are having their so-called loyalty to the president questioned?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, Mari Stahl is just the latest example of one of these situations. I broke a number of stories last year about career staffers being targeted for, you know, their loyalty question. And, you know, what happened was that when Trump took over, a number of conservative media outlets started publishing lists of staffers who they called Obama holdovers, even though some of these people had been working in the government, you know, since the Bush years or even longer than that, sometimes decades. And they said that these people, these conservative media outlets, were saying that these people have to be fired. So what you ended up seeing was, you know, some people would describe it as a witch hunt. I mean, some of these folks felt like they were being targeted only for doing their job. One particular woman, she's an Iran expert. She joined the government during the Bush administration. And she's born in Connecticut, but she has Iranian ancestry. And she was on, she had a very high-level appointment at the State Department. She was on the policy planning staff. And she had only 3 months left on that detail before going back to her regular bureau. But because of the conservative media attacks, or it looks like that, the conservative media attacks spurred a whole bunch of emails between the White House and State Department officials about what to do about this woman, because these conservative media outlets were attacking her. And so they, for no apparent, you know, actual reason, they simply kicked her out of the policy planning job 3 months early and basically sent her into exile. And it was just a really stunning example. And it was, and, you know, there was some questions in her case that maybe she was being ethnically profiled, because some of these emails about her that were being sent around by Trump administration officials, some of them claimed that she was born in Iran, even though she wasn't. And so, you know, people, when something like that happens, it just really, really worries these career employees. And Mike Pompeo himself has said publicly that he's not going to tolerate this kind of behavior. He and his spokespeople have said political retribution will not be tolerated. And yet, the people who were involved in this woman's case, you know, none of them, to our knowledge, have been reprimanded. And so this is why people are still worried.
Finally, in the last 60 seconds we have here, do you believe there will be major policy shifts at the State Department under Mike Pompeo, or is it merely that he's in the president's inner circle in a way that Tillerson arguably never was and therefore is more influential in his role overseeing the State Department?
I think it depends on what particular issue you're looking at. On Iran, I think the U.S. is definitely going to become much more hawkish. This is what Trump wants as well. On North Korea, who knows? It just kind of depends on the negotiations. But, you know, today also, Mike Pompeo made it sound like he is fine with cutting the State Department's budget. And that was something that was also interesting. So I think generally speaking, it's going to be a more hawkish State Department. And part of that is because Pompeo not only gets along with Trump, but actually he believes in a lot of what Trump believes in.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
I've been speaking with Nahal Toosi, a foreign affairs correspondent for Politico and author of the June 25th article, Pompeo Gives U.S. Diplomats Dose of Reality After Early High Hopes. You're listening to Trump Watch on WBAI New York. My name is Jesse Lent. And that's going to do it for this week's show. One quick note, we will be back at 6:30 and every like we are every week. And I just wanted to ask you, if you are podcasting this show at iTunes, please consider giving us a rating or a review. It's a great way to let other people know about the show. For everyone else, you can hear all 75 episodes of Trump Watch with Jesse Lent at soundcloud.com/TrumpWatchWBAI or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Facebook or Twitter, where our handle is TrumpWatchWBAI. And I'll be back next Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. when we'll break down another aspect of the Donald Trump administration. Until then, I'm your host, Jesse Lent. Talk to you next time. Thank you.